Hey, welcome to Bishop Justice. It's Masters Week, spring break. Got my grandkids, I got allergies, I got the pollen, but we're here, and thank God for it. Let's go to the biblical scripture we have today. The Lord is my shepherd, I have everything I need. That is Psalm 23:1. Well, we have a lot of letters, a lot of phone calls I get from all over the country, all over the world, because you know, after we run the show on the local media, it goes on YouTube, and then this goes to about 35 million different viewers. But we thank you for everything you've been calling in for, and I'm constantly praying for you. So you asked me to pray for you. I have not forgot about you. In the news is short and brief today. It's Masters Week in Augusta, Georgia. That's all I can say. And the reason why I'm going to be short and sweet, because we have a very, very special guest today, and we want to devote most of the time to the show to him. With that said, we have Sheriff's candidate, Captain Scott Peoples, that is here today and took time out of his busy schedule to come here and share his agenda. And in my opinion, I think he'll be the next sheriff of Richmond County, Georgia. Captain Peoples, how you doing?
Thank you for having me. I appreciate you.
First off, Scott, can I call you Scott?
Absolutely.
Scott Peoples. Who is Scott Peoples?
I was born and raised here in Augusta, Richmond County. I attended public school in Richmond County and graduated and then went to the sheriff's office at the age of 19. And I've been there for nearly 21 years. So if you're doing the math, that makes me 28 years old.
Okay.
fuzzy math, of course.
Right.
But no, it's been my life. I've enjoyed working at the sheriff's office. I've moved up through the ranks, and I just enjoy helping and serving people.
Right.
And I think that's what law enforcement is supposed to be about.
Right. You know, when I was in the military, I went from field artillery to military police. And military police is like a totally different organization within itself, within the Army. But I've learned over the years to not prejudge. What have you learned in being in the sheriff's office?
You know, it's funny that you make that point, because I think that there's a point in, especially in a young law enforcement officer's career, mm-hmm. where I think it's hard not to pass judgment
right.
sometimes, and you have these preconceived notions about not just what people are like, but what all of society is like, and that comes from a lack of balance, I think.
Right.
So when I look back at who I was 20 years ago versus who I am today, I'm a much more mature, much more balanced person. And I think that's important for law enforcement, to have that balance and to have a connection with the community. And so I think it's the most important thing.
You know, when I met you many, many years ago, but every time I've met you, you've been very, very cordial. Very, very nice. I mean, you always, hey, how you doing? You know, hey, you know, but a lot of times, you know, the sheriff's department gets a bad rap because they're not like that. But I have never, ever seen you not say, hey, how you doing? How's things going? Anything like that.
Well, I've learned over the course of my career, everyone I've come in contact with, I give my cell phone number to where they can call me personally.
Right.
And I think that when you're a public servant, it's about wanting to help people and having a genuine concern for their problems.
Wow.
And sometimes their problems may seem insignificant with the problems that you deal with every day, but to them it's very important. And when someone reaches out to you for help, that's a big deal to me. And I think that it's our job to improve the quality of life for our citizens, and so we have to be responsive to their needs.
You know, you made a good point, because when somebody reaches out to you, you don't never know, that's a life or death situation. They might be on the edge of being suicidal, and that might be that one word, one thing that you said that kept them here on this planet, and that's strong.
And let me tell you the flip side to that, and this is what I came to realize after I've done that, but you know, a lot of people tell me, why do you give your cell phone number out? I bet your phone won't quit ringing. I bet people bug you for the silliest things.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't.
Right.
People really don't call me and ask me for things. A lot of times what has happened is I get calls who are giving me information, and they felt a connection with me. They
right.
felt like I was honest and that they could trust me.
Right.
And the fact that they had my number had something to do with that, probably. But they'll call me in the middle of the night and say, hey, are y'all working a murder? Yes,
right.
we are. well, you need to check this out. This is what I just found out. And so that's a big deal. And when you have that kind of rapport and trust with people, and that's important for all of our law enforcement to have that kind of rapport and trust.
And that's strange because, you know, the reason that urged me to come today, I wasn't even feeling good. I wanted to cancel.
The pollen's killing us
both,
I think.
I wasn't feeling good at all, and I hate to not have my put my best foot forward,
I understand.
But the fact that this race is so important to Richmond County, tell me about your platform.
Well, my platform is simple. Right now, we are a professional law enforcement model, and basically what that means is when a crime happens, we go and investigate and we respond to it. We do some proactive stuff, and you've seen some of the stuff we put together over the years, but when we moved to community-oriented policing, which I think most of the candidates want to do is move to a community-oriented model, is we get more involved with the resources that are out in the community. As you know, budgets are tight everywhere. Right. We don't have unlimited resources. We don't have what we want, right, but we have to do our job anyway. And so there are resources that are out in the community, organizations that can help law enforcement on the preventative side. Right. When we get involved in the communities and tackle the problems that not necessarily are crime, but they create an environment in which crime can thrive, that's how we make changes in our neighborhoods.
So what do you see as the, not the low point, what do you think, if you elect a sheriff, which I think you will be, what is going to be the first thing you want to change? You always got to put your stamp on it.
There's got to be a paradigm shift, and when it goes back to what I think that in law enforcement, sometimes if you don't force officers to have balance in their lives, there tends to be, especially with younger, newer officers, there tends to be this us versus them mentality.
Right.
There's the police, and then there's everybody else,
right,
and we only trust each other. Right. And I think that when you force people to get out in the community, look, it's very reasonable to have that kind of tainted view when you go to work every day and you see the worst that society has to offer,
right,
or you see good people in their worst circumstances. Everybody, it's bad all day long. So we have to be involved, not just when we're taking enforcement action, but we need to be in the churches when there are days that they have where the community can come in, different organizations. We need to be there, and we need to encourage our officers to go to these types of things, because then they see, oh, there are good people out here just like me. They are just like me. There are good people. Not the whole world's not crazy or bad or, you know,
so
criminal.
So you're saying that there need to be, you encourage more involvement in community,
more involvement
with your deputies.
And I think that when you do that, the deputies will see that the community really wants to help. They want to be a part of the problem-solving mechanism.
Right.
And maybe they wouldn't do it the same way you would do it, but we need to open our minds. Look, the reason we've been successful with these operations that we've run, Augusta Inc. and Fox Hunt and Smokescreen, is mm-hmm. because we thought outside of the box.
Right.
That wasn't something we've done before. It wasn't normal to us. It wasn't habit for us. We had to think outside of the box and think of new ideas, and that's what we have to do. We have to be open to new ideas.
That sounds great because, you know, when I first became a military police officer, when you rush into a situation, You get the phone call and you take that person's side of it. But there's two sides to every story. So as you've gotten older and mature in the police department, when you go into a situation, do you now recognize there's two sides to a story?
Absolutely. And I even found myself doing that same thing as a
right.
supervisor. I'd get a phone call and it would be a complaint about right. one of my guys, and automatically I'd just be so mad about what I'd heard.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I would kind of, rather than get both sides of the story first, you
right.
know, jump to conclusions. And over time, I've learned,
right.
always investigate.
Yeah.
Don't jump to conclusions. Don't always get both sides of the story. And, you know, you said there's two sides of the story. We always say there's three sides. There's
yeah.
your side, my side, and the truth is somewhere
yeah,
in
yeah.
the middle.
The
so,
gray area.
but yeah, we have to give everybody their hearing.
Right.
Everybody needs to have the ability to tell their side
right.
of the story.
Right. You know, as sheriff, I think you're doing a wonderful job. I'm thinking, though, you just did a remarkable, tell me about the situation you just had with the...
With the smoke screen?
Right, right, right.
Well, that's a situation where we learn to think outside of the box. What we know that property crime has been a big deal
yeah.
because of the economy. And so everywhere in every city in this country, there are fencing operations, mm-hmm. whether they be private residents that are out in neighborhoods or businesses who are acting illegitimate who are buying stolen property. And that's feeding the market for these burglaries and thefts.
Right.
And typically in law enforcement, when we find out about those things, our first response is, hey, let's go shut them down, lock them up and shut them down. Mm-hmm. And the result is not really very, you know, traumatic. So when I was in the FBI Academy, I was in a counterterrorism class, and the instructor asked this question of the class. He said, if you found that someone was making false identifications for people who were coming into the country illegally or potential terrorists, mm-hmm. what would you do to those people?
Right.
And everybody in the class, being law enforcement, gave the response, we'd lock them up, we'd arrest them or whatever. And he said, no, you fund them. Because mm-hmm. when you fund them and make them work for you,
right.
now you find out all of the other things that are going on that you did not know about. You find out who the people are that are
right.
getting the false identification. So, and you find out what they're really up to. So based on that, when we found this this business that was operating as a fencing operation,
right.
that's kind of the philosophy that we employed. Okay, rather than just go shut him down, mm-hmm. let's get him to work for us. Let's
right.
find out who's out here breaking into all this
right.
stuff. Takes a lot of work, but it paid off big dividends.
Well, you know, patience is the key. I mean, short-term fixes, like you said, don't work. You got
right.
to sit there and evaluate and watch things over a period of time. And then, like you said, you get a get a bigger net. Tell me about your relationship with the outgoing sheriff. I talked to him a couple of months ago. He just told me, he said, Bishop, I'm tired. He just said, I'm tired. I said, what you going to do? He said, I'm through. I'm tired. He told me that personally, one-on-one, months ago. So it's no secret now because he's already said he's retired.
Right.
But he just said he's just tired.
He is. He's been in law enforcement for 35 years. As long as I can remember anything, I remember
yeah.
him being at the sheriff's office. And he's been like a father to me. But here's the important thing. And I think he's done a wonderful job. I think he's been the best sheriff this county's ever seen. But I think times are changing. And I think that we have to change a bit. And that's not a knock on him. I think he's done a great job.
Right.
I just want to take us in a little bit of a different direction. And I've done well under his administration because he's given me an opportunity and I've shown him that I can do the job he's asked me to do.
Right.
But that doesn't mean that I would be a carbon copy of him. I think he's done great things, and there's things that I would follow, and there are things that I would do a little differently.
Well, I mean, you got to put your, like I said, you got to put your own stamp on it.
You do.
I'm from, you know, I live in Somerville off of Wrightsboro Road, but my roots are South Augusta, Green Meadows. And so that's Sheriff Webster, Sheriff Striff,
right.
and the whole crew that we try to make sure that the people that get elected are going to serve the people. And that's what he does. And I know, I talked to you, I know you will. I think that you will serve the best interest of the people. Not Scott Peoples, but the best interest of Richmond County. Elaborate a little bit on that.
Well, I think that people don't understand when, and this was a big deal for me to decide to run. You know, for a long time I thought, well, maybe I'll run for sheriff. But it is a huge sacrifice. Your family has to make a huge sacrifice.
Right.
It's not just you.
Right.
You have to be available. You have to be approachable. You have to be someone who is willing to go out and solve people's problems. And it might be 1 o'clock in the morning. It might be when you are having a birthday party for somebody,
yeah.
but when you choose to take that role on, then those are the sacrifices you've decided to make, and you have to be true to people. And so being sheriff isn't about, oh, look at me, I'm the sheriff, you
right.
know, and how important it might make somebody feel. It's about being a servant.
Right.
It is about serving people, and then if I were the sheriff, then I would make sure that all of our people knew that our job is to serve people,
right.
to help people, not oversee people.
Right. You know, I don't want to bring up other candidates. I normally don't do anything. I don't want to spotlight anybody. But what do you got coming up as far as campaigning on the horizon? Qualifying on into May 25th, so nobody's a candidate to May 25th.
We are 4 months away from just the primary,
right.
so this is going to be a long campaign season.
Yeah.
And And, you know, a lot can change, but, you know, we're just going to be out there at public events. You'll see us. Everybody sees us out there. And anytime anybody gives us an opportunity to come speak to them, whether it's one person or an entire organization, and they want to know who Scott Peebles is, then they can do that. They can contact me by email. They can contact me by phone. Right. My website is peeblesforsheriff.com. It's very simple. Okay. And if they want to find out about me on the website, then they can go and look at the website and see what direction I would take the agency in. But if they want to know more, contact me directly and I'll come running to tell you who I am and what I would be.
Well, give me, what is one of your best characteristics? What do you say? What if somebody says, why you? Why you? Why Captain Scott Peebles out of the whole bunch? Why you?
I think my track record speaks for itself, and my track record isn't just my work experience. You know, obviously, I put together Operations Augusta Inc. and Fox Hunt and Smokescreen. But also on the other side of it, my track record is that I have been available to the community, not just because I want to run for sheriff and for the last 6 months I've all of a sudden become somebody you can get in touch with, but I've been this way for 10, 15 years.
Right.
And anytime people call, I go running. And I think that we have to be responsive to people's needs. And if I couldn't go, I got somebody who could go to help solve these people's problems. And that's what it's all about for me. I think that that's what separates me from anybody else running in this race, is not just I've got the training, I've got the experience, and I know how to do things, the organizational skills. Right. If these operations don't show you that I've got organizational skills, then, you know, I don't know what would. But it's just my genuine desire to improve this community, to help people and to improve this community.
You know, I think you're very, very sincere. Like I said, I evaluate the candidates and I try to look at who's the best person for the job, no matter color of skin. We can't get wrapped up, and I really don't want to get too in-depth in this, but the color of skin really shouldn't come into play. It should be who's the best man for the job, who's going to move the city forward, and who's going to take care of crime in Richmond County.
That's exactly right.
So, you know.
And the color of skin is you know, we have to acknowledge that people have differences. There are differences in culture. There are differences in races. But at the end of the day, that doesn't mean one is better than the other.
Right.
And we have to serve all people. And I think we've done that. I know I've done that. And I think that when you try and divide a community based on racial lines, that your motivation should be suspect at the very least, because we need to be bringing people together, not fighting each other. And I'm a white candidate, obviously, and the majority of Richmond County is black.
Right.
So I know the constituents, and I know who it is that I have to serve and want to serve.
Right. But, you know, one thing about it, now, since you mentioned that, so, you know, we know Richmond County is majority, I guess, black. I have to call Lynn Bailey and find out the demographics, but it might be.
It is. It's absolutely.
So what do you tell a black voter?
I tell the black voter, look, don't look at race, look at the candidate. Find out who has been available. Find out who has worked very hard out in the community, not just in West Augusta, East Augusta, South Augusta, not just one section, but everywhere.
Right.
And find out how that candidate has treated people when that candidate didn't need somebody or need something from them.
Right.
Find out who they were when they didn't need something.
Right, right.
You know, how available were they when they didn't need something?
Right. And, you know, the good thing you said, Captain Peebles, that this election is going to be very polarizing. It's going to get nasty, to make a long story short.
I think that it will get nasty, and I've already seen some of it, but it won't get nasty on our end. We're going to resist all urges. We are going to not run against our candidates or the other candidates or opponents, but we're going to run for us.
Right.
And this is who I am, and I'm not trying to tear down the other candidate.
Right.
I'm just trying to tell you who I am and let you make the best decision.
Yeah, I was, for lack of a better word, nasty was the only word I could think of, because when you talk politics, it gets dirty. But you made a good point. You're running a campaign based on who you are and what you stand for, and let everybody else decide the rest. And that's a very, very important thing. But I'm telling you right now, nobody else is going to do that.
Well, I know, and I've already, you know, it. I already know it's ugly. I've already seen some of the things that people will say about me. I've seen some of the things they'll say about the other candidates. And all we can do is block out all of that white noise, run our race, be true to ourselves, and at the end of the day, here's the reality. God's will prevail, what is meant to be will be, and we will be at peace with that. Right. We believe we're the best, and we want to move this community forward.
Right.
We don't want to get bogged down in the politics of old.
But, you know, I never, I mean, you said they say things, but I've never heard anything negative about you. I've been here since 78. My dad was stationed in the Pentagon. We came out here. I left in 82 and for college and the Army, but I've never heard anything negative about you, so... If you do have a weak point,
give it time. It'll come. I'm sure you'll hear it.
If you have a weak point or weakness, I'm not talking about as far as politics wise, but something, a shortcoming in your own self. What is it?
I think that my shortcoming, and I've matured, but my shortcoming was the way that I neglected my family for the job. You know, I have a lot of regret about that, my first marriage and my two daughters. I've had a long time to evaluate that and to think about that. And so now I'm remarried. I'm as happy as I can be.
Yeah.
And God's given me a second chance, so to speak, to try and get this right. And so it's about what we said, going back to balance and having that balance in your life. And so... I'm excited about the future for me and for my wife. And
you know, you said something that's very, very, family's number one to me, but sometimes people don't man up to realize they've made mistakes in the past and then, you know, understand the mistakes you made and try not to make them again. I don't mind a man making mistakes.
Listen, don't everybody makes mistakes. If you learn from them.
Right. Don't
keep
doing the same thing.
But that's the difference. Is, you know, how far removed are you from those mistakes?
Yeah.
And what impact did they have? And how did you change your life because of them? And, you know, obviously, I'm sure that if I were elected sheriff, I'll make mistakes. I'm not going to be a perfect person.
Right.
And I'm going to make the best decisions I can. And sometimes they might not be the right decisions once we go back and look at how things happened.
Right.
But I'll learn from those mistakes. And one of the things that I talk about is I think we do a really great job in the Criminal Investigations Division. We've got some of the highest clearance rates in the nation,
right,
especially when it comes to solving homicides. But what I tell my guys is this: no matter how good you are, number one, don't get arrogant.
Right.
And number two, there is somewhere that you can be improving. If you're so great, then where is the area that you're weak?
Right.
And then you start focusing on improving that weakness.
Right. Well, then don't abuse your authority either.
And absolutely don't abuse your authority.
You know, that's the thing that I noticed about you. You never have done. You've always been fair, always been a good guy. Can I say that about all the sheriff's deputies? Of course not. I mean, in everything in life, you got some bad apples.
Well, let's put it into perspective. There are 752 employees at the Richmond County Sheriff's Office. We are the largest full-service sheriff's office in the state of Georgia. Mm-hmm. Are we going to have good people make mistakes? Yes. Are we going to hire people who we find out are bad later on? Probably going to happen.
Right.
But it's how we deal with them when we find out what has happened and how we approach that. And I think if I can say one thing about Sheriff Strength, he has not played. When he finds out that there is some malfeasance within the agency, if it's illegal, he contacts me or the Criminal Investigations Division, and we lock them up. And we have arrested many a police officer.
Yeah.
And there is no, you know, people talk about this thin blue line. There is nothing more offensive to a good police officer than a bad police officer.
Exactly right.
There is nothing that offends us more.
Right.
So, you know.
Bad within the ranks makes you look bad.
Absolutely. It's embarrassing. It causes people who work hard to gain trust, it causes us to lose that trust.
Right.
And we take it very personally.
Well, the public looks at it, too. If they see that the sheriff's office is cleaning up his own people, then they have more what we call trust in the sheriff's department, know that you're going to do your job. And I think the sheriff has done that now.
He absolutely has.
Sometimes, you know, things that I think he wouldn't have fired somebody or put them on the red carpet, he hadn't played. I think you would do the same thing, but I think you would, like I said, you put your own stamp on the sheriff's office, but I think you'll be a little bit more less tolerant of a bad cops, corruption, the sheriff's
office. I promise you, nothing offends me more than that, and you know, so I totally take from his page, you know, that we cannot afford it, and if it happens, we can't try and hide it.
Right.
Get it out there, be honest with the public, or it's going to be 10,000 times worse. You'll lose their trust, and people are going to beat you up now. Yeah. Even when you do the right thing, when you've identified one and you take action against them, you're still going to get beat up.
Right.
But at the end of the day, people have to trust that you're going to do the right thing.
Exactly. And I know I've been through enough stuff in my life that I can wonder why I'm still standing, other than God.
Well, grace.
But yeah, well, a good man's steps is ordered by the Lord. And so I know you're a good man, and I know your steps are ordered by the Lord. If not, I wouldn't have you here. And I think that leading up to the primaries, we're going to have, see a whole lot more activity of you. Hope to have you back on prior to the regular election in November.
Right.
So we already have one Republican candidate that's announced so far. So I think at the end of the day in the primary was to be you standing.
I hope so. I appreciate your confidence.
I'm already making you the sheriff.
Well, I appreciate your confidence. And I tell people this, I won't let you down.
Right.
For people to put confidence in me is a big deal. And that trust is very important, and I won't violate it, and I won't let them down.
Captain Scott Pugh, we got to wrap it up. I'm glad I came today. I wasn't feeling good.
I hope you feel better.
I'm beat up, and we got to wrap it up again. Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you very much for having
me. I look forward
to
you being the next sheriff in Richmond County.
Thank you, sir.
Hey, with that said, make sure you patronize my sponsors. You see them at the end of the show. It's Masters Week. I predict Tiger Woods or Rory McIlroy to win. That's my prediction. Got my grandkids with me this week. And I'd like to say hello to them and hello to my wife. And with that said, thank you, God bless, for tuning in to Bishop Justice. We'll see you next time.
There's no question of your greatness, no searching of your power. Oh, the wonder of your glory. To you 40 years is but 1 hour. Your knowledge is all-encompassing. To your wisdom there is no end. Oh, for you alone are God. You are God. Mercy is everlasting. Your truth is here always. You are He who was and is to come. Who is He that can number your days? You flung the sun to burn in space, and the night's moon borrows light from day. Oh, you alone, your God, Elohim, you're everything I need. You are God alone. Now unto the King,
now unto the King,
eternal.
Turn on.